Hello and welcome to another edition of Tough Talk. My guest today is a career diplomat, a seasoned civil servant, a former permanent secretary of Water Resources, and also a former permanent secretary of Power, and currently the governorship aspirant of Bayelsa State, the governorship, PDP governorship aspirant of Bayelsa State. Ambassador Godknows Igali, many thanks for joining us on the program.
Thank you very much.
All right. A lot of people were asking, what is a career diplomat, a seasoned civil servant? What is he doing in the murky water of politics?
Both things that I did in my life, public service, were opportunities to serve the people. Governance is not just about rulership. Governance is about service delivery. It's about making life better for people. In fact, that's the philosophical basis for the existence of government, the social contract in which the government has a responsibility to make people happier, safer, more peaceful, and then the people yield their collective independence to government and trusting the government to look after them. So the opportunities that I had to work in this country in different places were opportunities to serve, but this is a higher calling, to still serve in a more robust manner. I think that is why we're out there. But we say murky waters, you may be surprised that some of these things, people think diplomacy is about champagne and about nice food and a la carte. It's sometimes tough. You do very serious national assignments, so it may not be too far away from politics. The partisanship may not be there, but always, sometimes assignments were very tough too.
Some people will say being a diplomat doesn't give you that experience of a politician.
No. Again, let me correct an impression. I started to work at the age of 22 in the federal government. And I was fortunate that in 1986, after my first posting, when I came back, the country was going into structural adjustment. President Babangida at the time wanted the crafting to bring in an economic dimension into the Foreign Service. So I created a trade and investment department, and I, three of us, started a department to provide some trade and investment component into structural adjustment to attract investment. Now, I mention it because we worked directly with the President through General Ike Wachuku, who was Minister of Foreign Affairs, and that's when we coined the word economic diplomacy. And we worked closely with President Babangida. Then later, from 1999, I found myself working with President Obasanjo. Then later with President Yar'Adua. Later with President Jonathan. And also with President Buhari. Why do I give this example? Because you are a civil servant. You are not strictly, you are not a politician. But you are where decisions are taken. Where these serious policy issues are taken that pertain to the country and to the welfare of Nigerians. Most times you have to even come up with a policy document. So you are not completely a stranger to issues of leadership and governance. You've been doing it, but you are doing it quietly, like they said, to be seen, not to be heard. So when you now migrate to a level of being political, you are coming with robust experience of governance. How is this country wrong? What are the problems? What are the challenges? As a matter of fact, even by the time you become a permanent secretary, you are the one to generate even problems and to the government and say, look, scenarios, if this happens, this is what you should do. If this happens, this is what you should do. So you've been, you are at the background, but you've been critical to how the country is and how the country moves forward and how the country can be better. And in my case, I was secretary of the Bayelsa State government. Don't forget, I was SSG. At the most difficult time in the history of the state, when the President, Governor Lamesia went down, fell, and President Jonathan, who was governor, then became governor. Don't forget that I was also advisor, honorary advisor, to President Obasanjo and later President Yar'Adua on Niger Delta and peace overall. So we worked closely with the presidency and brought a Niger Delta meant movement of emancipation of Nigeria Delta to the negotiation table. We later, under President Buhari, worked hard under the direction of our father chief, Ike Clark, to bring Avengers to the negotiation table. So you've been involved with critical assignments where you've dealt with matters, not maybe as a partisan politician, but as a primary witness and participant to policy.
A lot of people will say, after all said and done, it boils down to who is your political godfather for you to win any political office in Nigeria. So who is your political godfather?
I don't have one. God is my political godfather. You see, we sometimes exaggerate the role of political godfathers. Can a man even be able to add 1 inch to his life? This political godfatherism does not make any sense. Because most times, the people, the political sons, rebel against godfathers. Look at some of the states where people were saying that this man and me were yoked together and be son forever. After a few months, you see that they are fighting. I think what any politician or someone aspiring to political office should emphasize on is on what you can deliver. What can I deliver? Look at Bayelsa State. Go there on the street. Everybody say, bring Igali, bring Igali, bring Igali. Because people feel that this man can be able to take us to the next level. He can be able to take us out of poverty, out of ignorance, out of want, out of misery, to a place where we live like human beings of the 21st century, not people like of the 19th century.
In one of your interviews, as quoted in the media, you did say if you become the governor of Bayelsa State, you continue with the project of the incumbent governor, and that's Eriake Dickson. Does that explain the fact that he's your political godfather right now?
Well, Governor Dickson is my friend. He's in age, I'm a bit older than him. We had served together in the government of Governor Goodluck Jonathan when he was governor. I was secretary to government, and Dickson was attorney general. So we worked together, and I respect him. He's not my political godfather. Some say that Jonathan is my political godfather. He's not my political godfather. I've known Jonathan for a long part of my life. I had my career as a diplomat. Career diplomat, was doing very, very well. By the time I came back from Cameroon as Consul General, that's when I was in the villa and I later joined him. So I was not looking for a political patronage.
Okay.
Went to strengthen. But the same thing with Governor Dickson. So Dickson is someone I knew very well. He has worked very hard, I must say. He has worked very hard. And having worked that hard and been around his government, not as a public office holder, but as one of the senior people in the state, because I'm an establishment person, I believe that whoever is in authority, you have to support the person because the person is working for the common good. So, Dickson is not my godfather, Jonathan is not my godfather, both of them respect me, but my political godfathers, if any, are the people of Bayelsa State.
All right. When you went to take your form at the PDP Secretariat, you did say one of your focus is to make the state more productive and more entrepreneurship. A lot of people on the street of Bayelsa, when they look at you, they say, this is the man who has had the Ministry of Power. How can he make power stable in Bayelsa State? How can he make sure, because human capacity cannot be isolated. If you don't have power, then you don't even have any capacity. So what is the assurance are you giving them that, okay, if I become the governor, my key project or my main focus will be uninterrupted power supply for the people of Bayelsa, to beat renewable energy or the conventional energy?
Adela, thank you very much. One day I hope you give me a chance to speak with you only on power, not on any other thing, because there's a lot of misunderstanding of power and things concerning power sector in Nigeria. But coming to Bayelsa, it's very easy for me to stimulate power supply in Bayelsa State because I understand the sector very well. There's a lot of story out there that's not correct, it's not accurate. And now, why would it be easy to stimulate power supply in Bayelsa? The conventional power fuel source is gas. Gas at present is the cleanest and the cheapest source of energy fuel in the world. And Nigeria has 186 trillion standard cubic feet of gas, of which about 30% is in Bayelsa. There's gas everywhere in Bayelsa. What we need to do is to do our power supply system around the gas availability and be able to build small embedded. Embedded means it's not on the grid. You connect several communities, put the gas turbine there, or put the gas generators. There are gas generators, big generators that are not even turbines, that take the gas into one part and remove the strip, the purity, the purities and water and everything, and they push the pure gas into the generator to produce electricity So that's, we're going to look at solutions that are gas-based. Solar, yes, solar will be localized. If you are dealing with maybe some school, secondary schools, mm-hmm. hospitals, you can put solar. But for community uses and so on, where we can also be able to use machines and things for economic activity, you need a higher level of power availability. So there we look at gas.
What time frame are we looking at?
No, I tell people that within 2 years, there will be stable power supply in Bayelsa State.
Okay.
Yes, but in the state capital, in a couple of months after takeover, the regular power supply.
What kind of human capacity do you want to build, especially with the artificial intelligence that we have right now, that it's becoming the economy of the world? A lot of people have migrated from, you know, the resource-based economy to the knowledge-based economy. So if you're going to build capacity, would it be in that direction?
See, my benchmarking, what I tend to do in Bayelsa State by the SDGs, okay. is sustainable development goals, which the world says these are irreducible standards of all human beings to live if we get to the year 2030. Right now, a lot of Africans and people in the few developing world are living as 19th century people in 21st century. We need to make life safer, healthier, and people happier, and to live longer in peace and safety. When I tell people all the time, when I served as ambassador, my last post, before I became permanent secretary of Scandinavia, the average life expectancy is about 86, 85 years. Here it's about 52, 53 years for men and for women on the average. So it's terrible. Now, the things that stress people, that make them to live short, leave them to live sad, woeful. First, the availability of food. Can people be able to eat? We focus a lot on food production in terms of agriculture. Education. Can people go to school without all the hindrances? Yes, primary, secondary will be free and compulsory. If I see any child on the street, at the time when child should be in school, take the child. In tertiary education will be every student of Bayelsa or GOP on bursary. But girls who are studying engineering sciences and the medical sciences and certain serial basic sciences will be free scholarship, 100%. The same thing with teachers. 100%. By doing that, we can be able to deal with some gaps that exist. Now, why are we doing education, putting so much emphasis? I will have three special schools, one for gifted children, one for talented children, creativity, one for talented children, sports, so that they can be able to grow. We have a lot of vocational training institutions, three in one or each of the senatorial zones in the state. And we will do all that in education. Our schools will be very modern. Every child from secondary school age will have a laptop or an iPad. We are discussing some original manufacturers and people because of what you mentioned, knowledge-based growth. Where these children can, because these computers with programs, they don't go into wrong things. But they will have computers, so they can be part of the global information flyway and not be left behind. So these things we are going to do. And then on the health sector, related to education, there are 2 meals a day for children that go to school.
Okay.
And the health sector is connected with
Before we come to the health sector, still on education, if we've been following trend in the educational system right now, there's this called, what is called the rebel education, where people move away from the classrooms to go to the environment and, you know, face challenges in their environment and come up with solutions rather than the conventional classrooms. Are you looking at that direction?
Well, I don't want to bring models that are too sharply strenuous from us. You first have to...
But our curriculum has not been working.
No, but you see, you first have to build the foundation. Where today children are sitting on floors. Where today children are... Like maybe 100 in the classroom.
If people are moving with the classroom, they don't need classrooms.
When children are hungry. A lot of children go to school hungry. They don't eat. So, and studies have shown that for a child to study well and understand, comprehend, he has to eat well. So, where these basic things, where the environment is so filthy. So, we first have to deal with those things and now be able to go to the next level. I'm not unaware of what you're saying, I know it exists. For example, there's what the concept of lifelong education. When you don't just finish education, primary, secondary, university, and intermediate, no, all life you're studying through some special models and some special programs. So you look at the option of rural education, which I've read a lot about it, but we focus first on laying the foundation for solid educational development.
All of those things you're saying boils down to money, boils down to revenue.
And
you did say you would use your experience to attract foreign direct investment. So give us a breakdown how you intend to do that.
Well, I wanted to tell you something about health. Health will be very available to everybody, and we're going to cover everybody by health insurance. But certain special classes will have free health services, like those people, mothers, expectant mothers, and nursing mothers, people suffering from certain non-communicable diseases, cancer, hypertension, high blood pressure, stroke, and all diabetes, and all those kind of things, and other special classes. Now, how the money will come will be too. We are going to cut a lot of waste. Right now, waste levels are in many some states in the country, are most as about 40% of actual money that's expended. Because I'm going to put strict implementation of the Fiscal Responsibility Act to make sure that then the Public Procurement Act 2007 will be massed at a state level. Because a lot of the cost goes at level of procurement, the management of projects. We will avoid cut off waste, cut off impunity that comes with corruption, cut off projects that are not properly planned, therefore become abandoned. So by then we save money. But then we are also going to get some savings from de-emphasizing use of budget and money from federation account for infrastructure. We'll try to work to make sure infrastructure pays for itself, but we'll make counterpart funding and guarantees on our part as government and look for market-based solutions to infrastructure. When you do that, infrastructure is heavy. Building, for example, a road from Abuja to a place like Lokoja will cost hundreds of billions. Now, if you look for another way, an innovative way of funding infrastructure, you can make some savings. I'm not saying 100% of the money will come from private sector. No, there are other, some will come from government, but by way of guarantees and advance payments and a long-term borrowing that we need. I've been involved in doing these things. I was responsible for takeoff of such major projects like the Zungeli Dam. I went to China to negotiate the loan with China Exim Bank. I am responsible for Mambila. Even Mambila, the negotiation of the funding, mathematics and engineering, I did it a lot with the Chinese side. And there are many other projects of World Bank, Islamic Development Bank, African Development Bank. Look at the Ministry of Poverty now. The money that is coming in now, this year, $1.6 billion. I started a negotiation, dollars. I started talking with ADB, with World Bank, and with AFDB, that is Asian Francais Development. So we've been doing these things with JICA, with COICA, DFID, USAID. We've been doing these things. And also around the private capital. So it is not rocket science. We've been doing it. And I was fortunate that a lot of the big projects, I was involved in the financial engineering. When I was ambassador in Scandinavia, those are countries where people are very successful and happy people. They don't want to go anywhere in the world. At most, they trade with France, Holland, and so on. I convinced a lot of them to come to Nigeria. Now, today, we have hundreds of them. Before, there are companies in Lagos, in Abuja, in Kaduna, in Port Harcourt, all over the place. I had to market Nigeria. I had to market Nigeria. At the time, I brought President Jonathan when he was VP. We did a 120 business with all the big names that would take. Everybody was there. And they saw Nigeria. Today, they are all hurrying to come to Nigeria. We've done it before. And we're going to this time make Biosel an oasis.
How do you intend to market Biosel?
How do I intend to market Biosel? Biosel is one of the richest states in Nigeria in terms of infrastructure. Biosel has a lot of the best agricultural land in Nigeria. Biosel has a lot of fishery resources. The whole sea is in front of us. We have the largest coastline of Nigeria, 200 kilometers out of the 853 kilometers. We're the only state with that length of coastline. We have a lot of tourism potential beaches. We have a lot of resources in terms of oil and gas, particularly gas. So the investors, these are what they're looking for. Capital. Capitalism is based on profit. If profit is there and the right environment exists, security and so on, people come and invest. So we'll create the right environment and attract investment and make everybody to be functional, everybody to be working, to be productive. And they bring about economic inclusiveness and growth and wealth creation.
The program is still tough talk. We'll take a short break, and when we return, we'll be asking Ambassador Igali what will be his program for security, climate change, as well as reforming the civil service in his state. We'll be back after the break. Just stay with us. Program is still Tough Talk, and Ambassador Igali is still in the house. Don't forget, he's the governorship, the PDP governorship aspirant in the Bayelsa State forthcoming governorship election. Many thanks for joining us once again.
Thank you so much.
All right. Before we went on the break, you did say marketing of Bayelsa State. You talked about the potentials, the resources, the infrastructure, and all of that. A lot of people will say, before we come to the security part of the issue, climate change is real, the devastation is so real, especially countries and states that are on the coastal line, which your state is not, you know, excluded. The question would be, how do you intend to address that?
Climate change is real.
Yeah.
I was permanent secretary, federal minister of water resources, and I brought the alarm on the chart. And it was during my watch that we got presidential approval with the seed money for us to study how to reverse what's happening in the Chad, and then we were able to get some money also from the European Union, and we now engaged a consultant that came up with the water transfer project. It was my initiative because the Chad was 25,000 square kilometers in 1963. While I was there in 2010, it has shrunk to about 2,000 kilometers. 2,200-300 kilometers. Today it is almost less than 1,000 kilometers. So it is real. I was trying to deal with that. Now, coming back to Bayelsa, as you know, the melting ice in the North Pole is going to increase the sea level by 0.5 centimeters. And what that means is that it will drench, it will soak a lot of coastal towns. And we are, like you said, by the coast. A lot of our beautiful cities, Asian cities, are by the coast. So we have to look for strategies to bring more awareness of the effects of climate change that is affecting the rising sea water level, and also to look at areas, for example, the areas of coastal erosion, the areas of sea surge that is hitting the land and taking the land away. Then also climate change as it pertains to how do we adaptation measures. You see, and also resilience. How can we become resilient to some of the positive and the real reality of climate change? These are issues that we have to deal with, because in Europe, they are facing climate change too, but the ability to respond when disaster occurs. What is our disaster responsiveness? How are we prepared to deal with disaster? These are areas I would like to focus on when it comes to climate change. Why not building seawalls, for example, for some of the coastal cities, very expensive. But if you look at Nairobi, much of the funding for Nairobi's seawall came from donor contributions. We work a lot with donors. I know it's not going to be bread and butter, but if you package these things properly and you talk to the right people, they will see that there will be some levels of partnership to solve some of the problems of climate change. But I focus more on the response level, disaster responsiveness, how to manage, how to adapt to mitigate the effects of climate change.
You don't have preventive measures?
How do you prevent climate change? When we're planting trees, yes, we'll try to plant trees, we'll try to stop the aspect of, especially in the urban areas, because there will be more floods will happen, and people will try to open up as much as possible the blocked passages. You see, water has its passages that are thousands of years old. If water is passing here, you see, it may dry out this season, maybe for 5, 6, 10, maybe 20 years. But one day the water will come back. This is its course. So that's how nature God has made it. It will come back. Sometimes some rivers have dried up for like 30 years. So the water begins to come. So in the cities, where people see that the water is not, they just block it and build. I've already started engaged a group that is taking some historic data from satellite to see how, for example, the city of Yenagoa, the capital, looked like around 19. The earliest data we have in Nigeria was around 1913, which we have from my former Minister of Water Resources, Meteorological Services Agency. We are trying to look at the historic data of how those cities look like in terms of the various water passages. And if we see, even if it's my house, it's blocking away water before we bring it down, allow water to pass through. Because the climate change will bring more rains, there will be more tendency of flooding. And then we try to see where we can create blockage. See, we enter into the ocean.
Mm.
And I was in South Korea, then they have what they train the water, they dredge the parts that enter into the ocean. So when the water is about to enter, there are no sandbars that stop it. They clear them so the water can easily enter the ocean to reduce the extent of flooding.
An oil and gas state like yours has environmental degradation from oil spill, from vandalism, the gas flaring. I'm sure when you go to your local communities, you see the kind of life people live there and how much that has done to their health. Those ones in those particular people will be looking at you. What exactly are you going to do to help them save their environment?
Fortunately, oil gas flaring has reduced, but spillages still occur. Oil spillages are terrible, they still occur. Mm-hmm. And we work with the various regulatory agencies to bring this down. But more than that, to work with the oil companies, international companies and Nigerian oil companies, they must understand that they have a corporate responsibility to play the game by the rules. They cannot just come here and do what they like. There are countries, I used to live in a country called Venezuela sometime in my public life. And in that country, there can be an oil well here, and just less than 2 meters, there's a cassava. They grow. You don't even see, in fact, you don't even see one drop of black poop anywhere. So these are things that we have to make them know that they are wrong. And if they don't, they insist or continue with their own ways, we'll take the advocacy to their countries. And Ghana civil service said in their countries against what they're doing in our countries. So we are going to work a lot with them, get their cooperation for us to jointly tackle the effect of pollution. But also, you know, there is the UNEP report of 2011 on Ogoni, which says what is in Ogoni is covers almost all of Niger Delta, and there may be some worse areas. We'll look at the Ogoni report and see how it affects bias and try to work towards correcting it. Then the governor of Sereka Dickson set up a commission on environment headed by one Archbishop Sentamo from UK. And we'll look at their report and see how we can implement all of this.
Now, let's go to the issue of security, which is a big issue, the insecurity in the country from kidnapping to banditry and to Fulani headsmen, and all of that is threatening the unity of the country, and I'm sure your state is not, you know, left out of all of these security challenges. So what will be your first, what is your take on the current insecurity going on in the country?
Well,
is it political, as some people will say it, or do you think it's just pure criminality?
So unfortunately, we have this extent of insecurity. I would think that it may be a combination of a number of factors, and the appropriate people should sit down and try to examine this matter. I tell you this because I would like to give an example before I come to Bayelsa. But this the issue of a Fulani headsman. At a time in my previous life, when I was Nigeria's consul general to Cameroon, about 60,000 Fulani headsmen, not Fulani living in the cities and enjoying driving big cars. Fulani. They call them Bororo.
Yeah, Bororo.
So
yeah.
They moved into Cameroon because of a series of crises in the northeast. Fulani, Mambila, Fulani, Jukun, Fulani, Thief, Jukun, everywhere, Kutev, Jukun. So a lot of our population moved, about 200,000 people. And as Nigeria's consul general on the border, I was in charge of the border, 1,260 kilometers. I had to bring them back. President Obasanjo said, I want all these people back in Nigeria. And I don't like seeing report after report saying that Nigeria refugees. Because this is when we go to meetings, in major speeches. And yet, he said, bring them back. How do you bring back a people that don't want to come back? The Fulanis are very comfortable in Adamawa province in Cameroon. Very comfortable. More fertile land than us. The same thing with Tifemas, who are in the northwest of Cameroon. They have farm, land, it's more fertile. And the chiefs gave them land to farm yam. Fulanis, they gave them yam. And the local chiefs were happy because these 2 million cows went into Cameroon from the Mambila Plateau. Now, for me to convince them to come back, I had to go to their camps in the bush to be sleeping with them. They prepared a nice small camp out for me, and I used to sleep with them for about some months until I gained their confidence. Now, let me bring forward the story. When they finally agreed to come under the supervision of UNHCR, they now said that they called me to some and said, come, let us show you something. The day they were to go, the three, five of the Arabs, all will go to the back. They showed me some cows. I said, these cows belong to you. I said, no. They said, yeah, we are giving you 7 cows. Now, these are people, the same people that people say are killing people today. So, what went wrong? But that's not the end of the story.
Okay.
I met those people and I was in the presidential villa after I came back to Nigeria. I even forgot that I have some cows somewhere. One day they said some Fulani people are looking for you from the villa, what they call Pilot Gate, the first gate. So I sent my driver to go and bring them. They came in. And he speaks Fufu.
Yeah.
So they started speaking. Then I recognized that we hugged ourselves, we made tea for them, they sat down. Three of them. They brought some pictures and these are your cows. The cows have now increased about 17. So these are your cows. We want you to know that your cows are nice. None of them have died. And if any of them die, we're going to, if we sell any of them, we're going to give you the money. They're increasing. So that level of faithfulness. I was happy and I wanted to put them in the hotel. They said they had to go back. I gave them money for bus. They left back, went back to Tarawa. The point I'm trying to make, Nigerians have always lived in peace. These are people that are not from same ethnic language, ethnic group with me, and they could look for me and came into the presidential villa gate, hoping, and it's not that they were very different between myself and this Fulani man you see on the day. They were a little bit of better, but so if not, it's the same people. So who is the person, are they being used, or somebody doing bad things and calling their names? We have to interrogate these things, and the rest of it, I think that young people have to be engaged in this country. A lot of our young people are not working. They have nothing to do. People 11 years, 10 years, 8 years, and so on. Graduation, no job. Every young man wants to carry a gun, moving up and down. He wants to have a nice home. He wants to have a girlfriend. The girls want to get married. And then live their life, raise a family, have a home. That's their everybody's desire. You know, I have dealt with young people who were into criminality. When I was in Cameroon, I took 140 young Bayesans who were people on drugs. Governor Lamisa gave them to me. And it was not easy the first few months of taking them there. But after some time, they came back reformed. Today, about 100 of them are doing very well. And they're all like going, they're all bringing their wife and their children. These are people so that are giving up arm robbers and so on. And I have so many other cases of young people that are reformed like that. So, this solving insecurity is to understand what is causing insecurity. Like in the case of this sentiment, let's understand what exactly is going on. And nobody should be in denial. Any government official who says Nigeria is very safe, you're a liar. You're a liar. It's not correct. It's not safe. There is a lot of insecurity. And let's solve the problem collectively by ourselves. Now, in Bayelsa State, I have been involved with MEND, Movement of Emancipation of Niger Delta, like I mentioned earlier. I've been involved with the situation with Avengers. And like this case I'm talking about with the Fulanis and the thieves, I had to bring them back. So, thousands, hundreds of thousands. So, I'm used to dealing with such critical issues. First is to work with the community leaders. The leaders, traditional leaders, will not have a say in my government. We need them to work with the government. They will not just be auxiliary. Work with them as critical stakeholders and leaders at different communal levels and be able to solve the problem. They must own this peace effort and this effort of security in our local environments and collectively now keep the state safe. But also use electronic surveillance. These days, even if somebody steals your mobile phone, they can track it down wherever they are. So we'll do all that. We look for work with the security services. We work with a lot of vigilante groups from the communities. They cannot carry weapons, they work under the police and the other authorities, but we train them and we train them for them to be able to be primary people that gather intelligence and pass on the security and so on. So we tackle security and but it's not as complicated because communities want to live in peace.
Right. If you become the governor of Bayelsa State, you need a civil service that is very proactive, that will be able to key into your agenda. But when you go to state level, what you have is civil servants who are less efficient and less proactive. So what are you going to do for them to meet up with your dreams and ideas that you want to execute?
Well, the civil service, I was a civil servant. Mm. Civil service is critical. People sometimes don't know how powerful the civil service can be.
Mm-hmm.
If you have the right form of directorate staff, assistant director, deputy director, and directors, and they are motivated, they are knowledgeable, then your state will do well, or the government. Because those are the people that take decisions. They are those that make the memos. Most times, ministers and power says only to listen to these people. Because you, a minister cannot, for example, empower, go to all the power projects in the country. But directors know which officer is in charge of which project. They report to them. So I have a civil service background, and I will work very closely with the head of service and try to make the civil service functional, right-sized and functional. I was involved with the president. I was still in the villa when we had a civil service reform under President Obasanjo. And we did a lot of things together.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot take everything there, but we borrow upon some good things. And I know a few states too have done some reform in the civil service.
Okay.
We try to follow them.
Okay. Most aspirants and most candidates like yourself are very happy when they want to go into the elections. They're so excited when they win. But when they get to the books and they see the level of rot that the last administration left in terms of loan, in terms of wastages, in terms of malfunction of the system, they get very agitated, they get demoralized. And at the end of the day, they spend the best 2-3 years trying to fix the best that has already been created by their precedents. So what are you going to do if you find that kind of mess?
No. Government is a continuum. I will try to follow where they've reached.
Mm.
But secondly, I will not waste my time on a wild goose chase, chasing people all over the place. There's so much work to be done.
If you get to
meet
strangulating loans, what are you going to do?
No. See, you schedule the loans. You have a loan management, debt management. We are going to have a very strong debt management office.
Okay.
I will take a lot of loans myself.
Okay.
But the model of development, you see, if you take a loan and you build a good road, people don't complain. You take a loan and you make people to be happy, they don't complain. But if you take a loan and they don't see what you do with the loan, that's when people grumble and they are not happy. So loans are not bad, but it should not be things that suffocate the people and they don't produce anything. So loans or debt is not the issue. If I have the chance God gave, as I believe that God will do, I will focus on my work. There are people that will look into the loans and want to do the loans. But I will focus on my work. And I ask the professionals to look into these things and advise me. And I know how to go forward. But how to go forward is not to be chasing anybody around. No. It's what to do with what we met on the ground.
Let's paint a scenario. Forget about the cameras. If an average Bayelsa man takes you to the corner today and say, look, convince me why I should vote for you, or why I should support you to be the next governor of Bayelsa State, consider the fact that many people have promised us and they never fulfilled those promises.
I want to tell you, I tell you a lot of stories in my life, many stories, but I want to tell you one short one. My father was a headmaster, a very prominent headmaster until the early 60s in Bayelsa State. And in 1963, about that time, he decided to go abroad to the United Kingdom to go and study. And he had 3 children from my mother who were little. I was a young girl, 3 years old.
Yeah.
My father decided to, he didn't leave us with his relations. He took us far away from our town and kept us in the house of a man who had a lot of integrity and name. Integrity and name. Not his relation from my mother, not relation from him, but from another, what you call clan, from another like sub-tribe who is not related to him because of the character of that man. He was a priest and he grew up, raised us up. And he said, now, the thing I'll tell any Bayelsan is, look at the candidates. If you are faced like my father with that kind of decision, which of these candidates will you take your children to go and give? He was sure that this man is not my relation, but my children will grow up well. And we are not the best, but we have not done too badly, the three of us. So what I'm trying to say, I'll tell the Bayelsan that this election is about the future, about our children, about the next level. You can take decisions out of impulse and regret for 4 years, regret for 8 years, and regret to grumble, governor is this, governor is that, but then you did it. I'll tell them to think. Right now, it's like you carrying your children to go and keep with somebody. Whom will you keep your children with? That's what I'll tell them to think. I offer the best answer to Bayelsa State. I'm offer, the other candidates are wonderful people, great experience. in different areas. Mm. But you must look at things in their completeness and see who best represents the hope and the trust. Who do you trust for the future of the state? That's what I tell delegates when they come to see me. Mm. I say, delegates, it's trust. This election, who can you entrust this state to? Mm.
Finally, you talked about candidates. You've been needing so much money to give candidates, either as welfare or allowance or what have you. Secondly, elections in the Niger Delta are very, very volatile. Sometimes your winning depends on the number of militant or talks that you have. Are you prepared for all of that?
Talking about money, I was a civil servant for most of all my life. Mm-hmm. Civil service is not about money. I don't have money. I'm comfortable as a former pamster. Mm. The permanent secretary should go with your salary. And a few little allowances for us. Mm. So, but I have a family to take care of. I don't have money, but my friends are very generous and very kind. And I think I have a lot of goodwill because I served and served and served. So people are always there when there are issues, they run to me. Mm. To me. I say, oh, ambassador, I wrote this small thing. So that's how we have been surviving. And there are some people who come to me, oh, money. That's why after a few days, I see they join other guys. One told me to my face, you don't have money. Mm. So this election is my last election. You see my age, I have to be where the man can bring money. I said, okay, go ahead. Well, don't come and regret and complain. So we're trying to get reach out to friends, and they have been very supportive.
Okay.
And I thank them. But the issue of violence, I don't think so. A lot of the candidates we know ourselves. We've grown up together. We've been in government together, we've been friends. So I don't think any of us will unleash violence against each other. And if there are people that even come to offer violence, we will train ourselves and reject it. And so there will be peaceful elections. I think the voice of pessimism will not come to pass.
I'm afraid we just have to leave it here. We're looking forward to you winning the primaries, and so that we can come back and talk about what you intend to achieve in 100 days, in 1 year, and 4 years. And we do wish you the very best of luck in the forthcoming primaries.
Thank you.
Yes. Amb.Godknows Igali, thank you very much indeed for your time.
Thank you,
Madina. Yeah. And that's the show. Tough Talk will be back next week. Same time, same station. Bye for now.